Welcome to State of Mind, Being Human and Living Well, broadcasting on KSQD Santa Cruz 90.7 FM and live streaming at ksqd.org. I'm the producer and host, Deborah Sloss, licensed marriage and family therapist, and my pronouns are she, her. In the year 2020, a study concluded that 28% of Americans had tried yoga, and today about 36 million Americans practice yoga. Indications are that number is steadily rising. While the practice of yoga in general aims to cultivate body and mind, and therefore has the potential for therapeutic effects, in yoga therapy, specific and personalized yoga practices are employed to help alleviate or seek improvement for physical and mental health ailments. Many people learn about yoga through its physical practices, but a common misconception is that it's all about stretching or movement. In fact, yoga therapy can help people who can't move at all. As we'll learn from one of our guests today, whose use of yoga therapy helped her recover from a serious accident that had wrecked both her physical body and her mental state. Let me just say that yoga is near to my heart. I first discovered and started doing yoga about 35 years ago after I had been in a car accident and was trying to heal both physically and emotionally from those injuries. I'd been going to physical therapy and while there getting some massage therapy. But my back and neck pain could flare at any time and rarely waited for the days when I had my physical therapy scheduled. So what I came to love about the yoga was that I could help myself feel better in the moment that I was having pain or discomfort. I could do it anywhere, and I always had it with me. I just recently learned about the existence of this specialized practice called yoga therapy. So I'm excited to learn more about it along with all of you as we talk with our two guests today, Melanie Seacat and Dr. Juco Holiday, and hear about what yoga therapy is, how it works, and who could benefit from it. Let me tell you more about our guests today. Melanie Seacat's passion is learning and teaching self-empowered, holistic approaches to healing and spiritual development. After a near-death accident left her wheelchair-bound for months, Melanie recovered under the guidance of yoga therapy and somatic experiencing practitioners skilled in body-based methods for resolving trauma. This transformational experience inspired her to transition from her former career in environmental sustainability to helping people learn tools for embodied, sustainable healing from the inside out. Melanie is now working in private practice as a certified yoga therapist and somatic experiencing practitioner. She loves igniting passion in her clients to learn experiential mind-body skills and making it fun and achievable. Melanie works in person in Arizona and online and teaches yoga therapy for mental health at the Optimal State School for Yoga Therapy. Dr. Juco Holiday is an integrative mental health practitioner, meditation teacher, and certified yoga therapist. Her introduction to yoga was as a child in the 1970s, following along with the PBS show, Lilias, Yoga and You. Her first students were a group of classmates she rounded up to play yoga during recess, a move that led to being punished and prayed over by the principal of the fundamentalist Christian elementary school she attended in Ohio. This strong reaction left her with the sense that there was more to yoga than the fun stretches she enjoyed, and was the start of an exploration that has lasted for nearly 45 years. In that time, life has given her plenty to practice with. Learning to manage a life slowed by depression and PTSD, being one of a handful of black students at an Ivy League university, pushing through obstacles to earn a doctorate in psychology, taking ordination vows in the Soto Zen Buddhist lineage, and losing her house and nearly all of her belongings to recent wildfires. She's the founder of Ease Mountain, a yoga center in the Santa Cruz Mountains, has taught meditation to groups at USC, Facebook, and Google, and offers in-depth training for yoga teachers, yoga therapists, and mental health professionals who want to bring yogic tools into their clinical practice. So excited to welcome both you, Melanie, and Dr. Juco to the show today.
Good to be here. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much for having us here. Very happy to be here.
Well, I'm just so excited to be talking about this and also to get the opportunity to learn more about it myself. So I was thinking, why don't we go ahead and start today, Dr. Juko, with you? And I'm wondering if you could tell us what yoga therapy is and how it might differ from other studio yoga practices that people might be more familiar with.
So that is a big question. And I would say that of all the different ways that one might define what yoga therapy is, the key is that it's specific. It's an individualized, very particular application of yogic tools for a specific therapeutic goal. And that aim could be psychological, spiritual, physical. And it differs from what I will call fitness-focused yoga asana. Asana is the postural practice that we're most familiar with. It differs in that it is not that the person offering it comes in with a set of postures to teach that is decided beforehand. So yoga therapy emerges from the client's needs as opposed to a sequence that is designed beforehand.
And does it involve other things besides the physical movement?
Oh, absolutely. As a matter of fact, what I would say is that if we think about the postural practice, the physical movement in the context of all that yoga is, that it's a very little part of it. And so people who might be curious about yoga therapy and say, oh, but I'm not flexible or I can't touch my toes, there isn't a lot of that in the way that I practice yoga therapy and in my experience. And so there is this piece where it is expanding the notion and what we experience as yoga to include other tools and other limbs of yoga.
Just to get a picture of how this exists in the world, how widespread is it and how available, and who are the people who would provide yoga therapy?
Well, I want to speak to the present, and then I want to speak to my fantasy and what my vision for the future. So I would say, first of all, that it is not as widespread in the United States. And thank you for reminding me that I need to contextualize what I'm speaking about, because I can only speak to yoga therapy as it's delivered here in the United States. Obviously, in India, where yoga emerges from, it's an entirely different context. So it is much more widespread, much more available, and wouldn't need a podcast to explain right what it is or to explore it in depth. So it is not as available or as accessible as I would love it to be. There is a really important organization called the IAYT, which is the International Association of Yoga Therapists. And they have been around for 3 decades, and they accredit training programs and they certify people who are trained as yoga therapists. So that is a great place to start in terms of looking for a yoga therapist. There are dozens of accredited programs, but it's not as common as, say, psychotherapy, right? So it's not as easy to find. And I'm 51. And so I thought, well, you know, 30 years or so, I'll spend this next 30 years or so really trying to make it that accessible, right? Which is why I have a training program and a passion, so that it becomes an option in the same way that, say, for example, acupuncture is something that is widely available. So that's the state of things now and my fantasy.
Melanie, I want to turn to you now, because 10 years ago, you had a near-death accident that led to traumatic injuries, and you were facing the possibility that you might not walk again. And you say that you were able to recover in large part because of your use of yoga therapy. So I'm wondering if you can first tell us about what was going on that led up to the accident, you know, how it happened and how serious your injuries were, and then we'll get into the yoga therapy part of it.
Yeah, sure. So prior to the accident, I had been in a 25-year career that was highly stressful, single mom, workaholic, and I was in my early 50s and I'd been going through menopause, and my system began to break down. I was exhausted, depleted, in adrenal fatigue, and my attitude was push through. So I got a permit to float the river, the Colorado River, through the Grand Canyon, which had been a dream of mine. I'd been on a wait list for 15 years, and I got the permit to run the river, and I was so excited. And I spent the next year at really what I would consider to be a military level planning expedition. These private river trips are no small feat to pull off. And when I finally got onto the river, I was really exhausted. And 3 days into the river, somebody on the trip proposed that we do a hike. And I was with a lot of very strong, athletic, rock climbing types. And we went on a hike that I didn't realize was going to be so extreme, but it was an extreme hike with a lot of exposure, rappelling down cliffs, free climbing, all of this. And I have a fear of heights to begin with, but this was what I do. I love to hike, and this was supposed to be fun. So I pushed through all my fears and went on this extreme hike. And there were many times when I feared for my life, and I made it through. But on the way back, I found myself on a cliff face on a small ledge, and I was trembling. I froze. I was sure I was going to fall to my death. And actually, my son was there. He was the only one there, and he talked me through it, and he got me across. And I was sure that that was the end of it, that I could get back to camp now. You know, that was the worst of it. But there was one last little thing, and it was a 15-foot vertical cliff face that I had to free climb down. And I was so anxious to get back to camp, I just kind of pushed through. I didn't rest. I didn't collect myself. And at the top of that, I was lowering a leg down to a foothold, and I fainted. My body actually went into a freeze state. And I fell into a rock spree, and I broke my pelvis. So that was the accident. At that point, I couldn't walk. I couldn't move, but we didn't know how bad the injuries were. And then 4 days later, I was helicoptered out, got my way back to Tucson, and went into surgery. So,
wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Very serious accident, sounds like. How did you come to be exposed to yoga therapy?
Well, interestingly, I had met a yoga therapist a couple months before the trip, and I had gone to her thinking that, you know, I'm a healthy person. So I thought I was in denial about all the underlying trauma and all the reasons that I was in adrenal fatigue. And I had been practicing yoga more, a style that was more yoga for power and strength, which is often what you find in yoga studios, very much focused on the form of the poses and the alignment. And I felt like, you know, I wanted to be able to do handstands. And so she kind of held up the mirror for me, and she had been trained in India exclusively, where they're very focused on ego mind. And it's not a bad word. It's not like you're egotistical. It's that the whole point is to get freedom and space from that ego mind.
And this was before you even had the accident, that you had started this?
Yes, this was before the accident, right? Mm-hmm. So I knew when I had the accident that that might be an avenue for me. And my yoga therapist was amazing. I mean, she showed up at the hospital. She drove me home from the hospital. She drove me to my first doctor appointment. She was Florence Nightingale. And she immediately gave me breath work to do right after surgery. And then once we heard what the doctor's orders were, which were strictly no weight bearing for 3 months, she, you know, encouraged me to be totally aligned with that. She encouraged me to get psychotherapy for the trauma. And she said, if you want, I can prepare you for physical therapy, because once you can walk again and you're going to be going to physical therapy, I can get you ready for that. And so I said yes. And I was just a person that was ready to really commit to this practice that she gave me, because I wanted to walk again. I wanted to heal. And so she gave me practices that involved lying on my bed, breath work, progressing to maybe some upper body movements, then maybe some ankle movements. And this went on for weeks and weeks. Finally, there might have been a little bit of bend your knee and slide your heel towards your hip. So starting to get into the opening of the hip, but it was so soft and gentle, and my body just was expanding. And now I understand how the nervous system works. I didn't really understand it then, but I now understand that I had been living in a survival physiology. I had been in high stress for so long that that was my normal. And I started to come down out of that. And I started to come into what they call the parasympathetic state, where you're resting and digesting and repairing. And staying in that, doing these practices 3 times a day and being in that place really was the key to a very rapid and very thorough healing, because my body could do its work. Specifically, the yoga therapy addressed my nervous system, which is our level of is the physiological state that we're in. And what they now know about the nervous system is it's far more than, you know, yes, it's influencing thousands of functions within our body, you know, our breath, our heartbeat, our digestion, our hormones, all of this, but it's also affecting our perceptions and how our mind is able to relate to things. And so by regulating my nervous system, getting me out of this fight, flight, stress, reactivity mode and into a calmer state, then a lot of my body's natural healing could really come online.
You're tuned to listener-supported 90.7 FM KSQD Santa Cruz, K-Squid, many voices, one station. And this is State of Mind, Being Human and Living Well. I'm your host, Deborah Sloss, and today we're discussing yoga therapy as a powerful healing technique for both physical and mental health ailments, and learning how it differs from other studio yoga practices. We're also hearing our guest, Melanie Seacat's remarkable story of physical and mental health recovery through her use of yoga therapy techniques following a life-threatening accident. Also with us is integrative mental health practitioner, meditation teacher, and certified yoga therapist, Dr. Juko Holliday. Stay with us, and we'll be right back after this brief message from our underwriter.
KSQD thanks Family Service Agency of the Central Coast for supporting this program. Family Service Agency provides counseling and support for people of all ages facing life crises and challenges. You can reach them at 423-9444 to see if they can help you. Thank you, Family Service Agency of the Central Coast, for supporting KSQD 90.7 FM.
Back to our interview. Well, Dr. Juko, I'd like to turn to you, because now after hearing Melanie's story, I'm wondering what you would want to say about Melanie's experiences of healing through yoga therapy, and what parts of her story are familiar or similar to what you've seen as a psychologist and yoga therapy practitioner, and maybe what aspects stand out as unique or different.
Well, first of all, I'm very moved, Melanie, to hear the story and the process of witnessing and testifying is an important aspect of the process of yoga therapy. And in particular, I was moved by the image of you progressing to a point where you could slide your heel and bend your knee slightly towards your pelvis after a long amount of time, and imagining you in that moment was very moving. And I'm also quite moved and elated that you connected with such a qualified yoga therapist who could look beyond your desire to do handstands to the depth of the practice, which is I'm so glad you extroverted this relationship we have with the self and this contextualizing our cognitive emotional self in a way that is balanced. And the imagery is I'm very, very moved by it. And I want to thank you for allowing all of us to bear witness to it. And the part that makes yoga therapy different and is also similar to the work that I do and the work that I've encountered is this attention to state of being that allows us access to balance. So Melanie spoke about parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous system. And obviously people who work in mental health, we are very interested in nervous system regulation. And we often see it as being calm. We often see nervous system regulation as being zenned out, or I'm going to meditate to relax, or I'm going to do yoga to relax. But regulation, from my perspective as a yoga therapist, is the capacity to cultivate an appropriate and skillful nervous system response to that which is arising in the present moment. And so sometimes I think of you there, afraid and pushing. And in those moments, a skillful nervous system, a regulated nervous system offers what you need to get safe, as opposed to bypassing the body's wisdom to get into the ego and say, no, I'm going to push through. I'm going to keep climbing. Right. And so I think your story is just a perfect example of how it works on multiple layers of the self. It's beautiful.
I'm wondering, Dr. Juko, if you can talk some about the kinds of conditions that yoga therapy can be used to address and maybe give some examples.
Sure. So I first want to say about that it is a bit tricky to produce evidence-based, peer-reviewed, random, double-blind, controlled trials of therapeutic yoga. As a matter of fact, it's nearly impossible. And so the list of conditions that people have used yoga therapy for is as broad as the list of conditions that exist, right? So my expertise is in using therapeutic yoga for people who live with the behaviors and ideations that we might label as mental illness, in particular, people living with low moods and high levels of stress. My focus is not as strongly on the physical body, so physical recovery, but yoga therapy has been used for people living with MS, Parkinson's. I would characterize it as NCDs, non-communicable diseases, are really ripe for the kinds of interventions that yoga therapy offers, the diseases and conditions that we think of as lifestyle diseases. So it's almost easier to say who is not a good candidate, and it is when someone is in an acute or emergent crisis. So Melanie's yoga therapy would not have been appropriate right after she fell, right? But once she was safe and stabilized, that's when that work could begin. And we are at the cusp of trying to find ways to test the efficacy so that there can be a broader acceptance of these interventions in the health arena at large.
Wonderful. Thank you. I do know that I've been hearing more news stories about yoga making its way into things like the veterans affairs kind of treatment programs. And so you want to say more about that? You're exploding, yes. Juko, Dr. Juko.
You see me like moving around. It's that I love that it can be that it can show up in unexpected places. So one of the crises that has emerged in the last several years is a crisis of soldiers and active duty military who've died of suicide, and the relationship between that and the prevalence of PTSD among armed services professionals. And one colonel, or maybe general, it's been a while since I've read this, said that it was the most fierce enemy he'd ever faced. And because that, because of the scope and the scale of the problem, they started to look at ways that were, didn't need to be approved in the same way, like a medication might need to be approved. And there was this opening to start to bring yoga therapy into the VA and to start to work with soldiers. So a lot of the evidence that we have about the efficacy of yoga therapy in PTSD comes from this tragedy and some beautiful forward-thinking folks who decided to look beyond the traditional scope to help the people that they were serving with. And so some of those techniques, it makes sense. Like, it can make sense on the face of it. So anything that will help someone regulate the nervous system, find a way to be comfortable turning attention inward, being able to navigate and manage the symptoms of PTSD, which all of the techniques that we use can support and help with. I think that is how it got to have an entry. In particular, yoga nidra, which is a type of deep relaxation, and actually a state of being, to go back to what Melanie was saying, where one finds that balance still center point.
Well, I'm just thinking of what you said earlier, which is, you know, just being able to regulate the nervous system enough to have an appropriate response to the conditions. And, you know, PTSD is exactly the opposite of that. So it really makes sense what you're saying, how that would be a helpful, central sort of focus to work on and help people develop that capacity again.
Yes. And the other pieces of it, the contact with other folks, there is a big piece of it, again, imagining Melanie's yoga therapist driving her and being there and visiting her. There's a relational aspect to it. One of the pieces that is more present in yoga therapy, more explicit than in fitness-focused yoga, is the relationship between teacher and student.
You're tuned to listener-supported 90.7 FM KSQD, K-Squid, Community Radio for the Monterey Bay. And this is State of Mind, Being Human and Living Well. We're also live streaming over the web at ksqd.org. You can find the podcasts of all our shows on Apple and Google Podcasts, Spotify and Stitcher, and on the KSQD website. I'm your host, Deborah Sloss, and today we're learning about yoga therapy, what it is, how it differs from studio yoga, how it works, and who could benefit from it. We're hearing about our guest, Melanie Seacat's physical and mental health recovery through her use of yoga therapy techniques following a life-threatening accident. Also with us is Dr. Juko Holliday, an integrative mental health practitioner, meditation teacher, and certified yoga therapist. I want to remind listeners that every State of Mind show has a resource list posted along with it, and the resources we talk about today can be found on the post for today's show at ksqd.org/State of Mind. Now, back to our interview. Melanie, I want to come back to you because you sort of indicated that you're a very different person now. At the time of your accident, you were living with many symptoms of psychological distress and trauma. And I'm wondering what those mental health symptoms looked like for you, and how would you say that yoga therapy helped you address those specific symptoms?
Yeah. You know, I think I would say that Before I started practicing yoga therapy regularly, you know, it really became like brushing my teeth. It became something that I was doing every day. And it started to take root in a very deep way, establishing a place where I could go, where I felt pretty stable, right? And I felt safe and I felt at peace. So it was driving me to be more deeply connected inside myself, but then also slow down enough to actually see, oh, what is the message of my body? Oh, what is the mood I'm in? Oh, look at that pattern of, you know, speeding up and talking too fast or getting irritated and impatient or, you know, all of those things. And so these unconscious patterns of behavior, it helped me to start seeing them and get a little space from them, right? So the mind, you know, one of the foundational techniques that I have consistently used in my yoga therapy from the time I could move was this triangle of the body, the breath, and the mind. And so it's not just moving, it's moving in coordination with the breath. So the breath is informing the movement, it's leading the movement. Well, that requires mental focus. And when the mind is focused in a chosen direction, what I experienced and what people say happens to them as well, other people, is that your whole system just starts to get quiet. So the mind quiets down and all of those conditioned responses and those patterned responses that muddy like mine, the silt just starts to drop down, right? And then suddenly your perception starts to be a little clearer because there's also this inner light, really, this peace that's there that I experience. And so once I'm dropped in like that, then I can actually see more clearly what's happening in the world. So then I'm freed up to make choices that are more in alignment with my deeper aspirations, right? Mm-hmm. On all levels of my mm-hmm. system. And so over time, it just became something where I started to see things in a light that was also self-compassionate, connected to myself. And then, you know, that translates into my relationships.
Speaking of that relationship with other people, when I spoke to you about coming on the show, you told me that you had felt that your use of yoga therapy had really transformed your relationship with your son. And I'm wondering if you could tell us something about what that change was and maybe give an example of how it actually showed up.
Sure. Well, as I said at the beginning, you know, I raised my son as a single mom and I was a super mom, you know, joined the club, right? I think so many of us try everything we can in our power to do our best for our kids, but I was also driven and motivated by underlying trauma, you know, with his father having, you know, died and also having had, you know, I'll just be honest, there was some emotional abuse, there was substance abuse, there was things like that going on. And so I was just driven to protect him. And I was trying to control his experiences way beyond the time when that was appropriate, right? And so I was also trying to regain some stability and safety in my life. I was the provider, so working really hard and being the super mom and also trying to wake up and do, you know, just trying to do everything in a perfectionistic way. And that's not real love. You know, I mean, at some point there became that tension that parents and children can have. And, you know, my son knew I loved him, but it was also at a certain point that I needed to let go and I needed to accept and allow and really be with him and letting go of my role as the mom that was, you know, trying to shape his life. Yoga therapy gave me that capacity to be very content within myself and very unconditionally accepting of all of his choices as a young adult going into an adult. And what he reflected back to me was incredulity. You know, he was incredibly impressed with how different I was. And he would say that to me regularly. It's like, Mom, who are you? And I love this. And it goes on to this day. You know, our relationship is better than it's ever been. And I credit that to yoga therapy, to finding that peace within and really learning how to love him.
Lovely. Thank you. Dr. Juco, I want to come back to you because you have your own story about how you came to be interested in yoga and healing through it. And I'm wondering if you could share about the mental health disability you were living with before finding yoga therapy as a method for caring for your own mental health. And how did that lead you to become a yoga therapy practitioner and trainer?
Yes, well, I was born in 1970, and in the wake of the civil rights movement and legislation that really changed my life as a little Black girl in Dayton, Ohio, drastically when compared to that of my parents and grandparents. And at the same time, that hope did not prevent the racial trauma that we now are able to witness that has been ongoing. And so there was that piece of living with that. And then within my household, I grew up with a mother who lived with schizoaffective disorder and a father who was a Vietnam era veteran. And he lived with undiagnosed PTSD. And so from a very young age, I was caring for my parents. I'm adopted. I was put in foster care at birth. I mean, there's been a lot to practice with. So I can summarize it to say that I have a very high ACEs score, Adverse Childhood Experiences score, and not any access to mental health support, in part because of the stigma that it has in my community and the availability, and also the way that it was delivered was not very resonant culturally. So my own journey took me through being diagnosed with depression 30 years ago. I was hospitalized when I was a student at Brown University and for a major depressive disorder, which in actuality was a diagnosis later of PTSD. And I happened to have the great good fortune to be in Los Angeles in the mid-90s when yoga, before it was a scene, and there was this introduction of it in that environment. And I was in psychotherapy and I was going to yoga, and there was something that I was experiencing within the class that seemed to connect with the insights that were arising in the process of psychotherapy. And I wasn't consciously connecting them at first, but there was something about even the structure of a class. I don't want to malign the way that we practice, the gateway so many of us have entered yoga, because it is centering and then challenging the nervous system through postures that might be challenging, and then bringing one back down again to a state of relaxation in Shavasana at the end. And there was something about that cycle of looping through that connected the insights that I was having in psychotherapy. So the insights weren't enough alone for me to find that sense of stability. And so over time, I started to put together that how I was feeling at the end of a yoga class was kind of how my psychotherapist was hoping that I could feel, right. You know, walking around in life.
Like the embodiment of your psychotherapy. Yes.
Yes. Oh, that is it. That is it. It is the embodiment of the insight. It's the aha. It's the container in which the mental sort of activity that happens in psychotherapy, the cognitive reflection, then gets to penetrate all these different layers of the self. And it then became my deep desire to try and make the experience accessible to others, because I believe deeply in the value of psychotherapy, deeply, deeply, which is why I trained as a psychotherapist and have that part of my practice. And at the same time, when we look at the prevalence, say, of cognitive behavioral therapy, it's like, wow, we're taking an apparatus that is compromised and then using that to try to unwind the knot, right, of these conditions. So to expand it into all the other layers of the self was the turning point. My emotional lability changed. it went from a place where I was okay. So I no longer met the diagnostic criteria, technically in remission, but I wasn't thriving. So in addition to the embodiment piece, it's going from not being mentally ill to actually being well and feeling a sense of wholeness and wellness. So it's that piece that's exciting and why I'm in it.
Beautiful description. Beautiful. You know, I'm also aware that this show is going to broadcast during Black History Month in February. And I'm wondering if you want to share anything about what it's been like to be a Black yoga teacher and a Black business owner and how those experiences may have shaped your work, especially with regard to your interest in yoga therapy.
Absolutely. I think that being a Black business owner in Ben Lomond, California, which is, I didn't even know that there could be such homogeneous places in California. And I came here in part as part of my healing process to be in a smaller city and to be in the trees. And what I'm struck by is that the extent and the depth of the racial trauma that I and my peers, my family have been going through was so profound that it is just now that we're even able to digest and begin to process it. So there's this idea in yoga that you can't be given a teaching you're not ready to digest. So if I start to talk about the nature of the true self with a capital S and someone doesn't relate to that, then it doesn't mean anything to them. And so what I notice is that it has taken this much time for us to even begin to look at the deep wounds that we have been just pushing through. And so there's that theme again of pushing through and pushing through. And what I find is that yoga therapy, yoga, and especially a new emergence of Black yoga teachers, we are finding our own way and developing, synthesizing the teachings in ways that also speak to us culturally to stop pushing through. So there's a wonderful Black yoga teacher in Atlanta called Octavia Rahim, and her theme, and she teaches rest. She teaches slow down. She teaches the capacity to shake off the stereotype of just carrying the whole world on your back. And so that piece is exciting. It's a relief. It hasn't been easy. So for a long time, I was the only Black woman in a lot of the classes that I went to. And so what I do now is, even in Ben Lomond, I make sure that all of my trainings and everything that I offer is inclusive and diverse. And I pull it off in ways that other larger organizations that say that they're doing it don't. And I'm a one-woman show. So the other thing that I want to say is that the therapeutic aspect of it, because it is different from psychotherapy, because testimony is a part of it, because modeling it is a part of it, I find it more accessible. So in psychotherapy, there is taboo against self-disclosure. There's a taboo against the therapist being as involved. And there's a distance that culturally is not very adept. And one of the reasons that a lot of Black folks just don't connect with psychotherapy as it is often delivered. And also why my caseload is full.
Yeah. Got it. Thank you. You're tuned to listener-supported 90.7 FM KSQD, K-Squid. Many voices, one station. And this is State of Mind, Being Human and Living Well. We're also live streaming over the web at ksqd.org. I'm your host, Deborah Sloss, and today we're learning more about yoga therapy as a powerful healing technique for both physical and mental health conditions and a tool for health maintenance. Joining us today is Melanie Seacat, who found yoga therapy was central in helping her recover from a near-death accident that had wrecked both her physical body and her mental state. Also with us is integrative mental health practitioner, meditation teacher, and certified yoga therapist, Dr. Juko Holiday. Stay with us, and we'll be right back after this brief message from our underwriter.
KSQD thanks Yoga for All Movement for supporting State of Mind. Yoga for All Movement provides no-cost, trauma-informed yoga to youth, low-income seniors, individuals in custody, and those in recovery. More information is available at yogaforallmovement.org. Thank you, Yoga for All Movement, for supporting community radio K-Squid 90.7 FM.
Back to our interview. So this is it, the final stretch here. And, time is going more quickly than any of us would like, especially me. I'm enjoying this conversation, learning so much. So at this point in the show, I'd like to give our guests a chance to mention any specific resources that they'd want to let our listeners know about. And I want listeners to know that there will definitely be more resources on the resource list posted with the show than we'll have time to talk about today. So Melanie, is there one or two resources you'd want to be sure our listeners know about?
I'd like to offer one. It's Yoga Therapy Hour with Amy Wheeler. And it's a podcast where Amy Wheeler is, she's a professor of kinesiology and psychology, sports psychology at Cal State San Bernardino. And she has a yoga therapy school where she provides an 865 yoga therapy training. It's called Optimal State. And she does this podcast where she interviews people from all, aspects of yoga therapy and psychology. And it's just a fascinating window into all aspects of yoga therapy. So I would just Google Yoga Therapy Hour with Amy Wheeler and check that out.
Great. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. Dr. Juko, how would someone in our San Francisco Bay Area find and access yoga therapy if listeners wanted to find that?
Sure. I would point to iayt.org. which provides a listing of certified yoga therapists. And I do want to say that that piece is important because someone who is certified as a yoga therapist has a minimum of 2 years of training, and the programs are minimum 800 hours, but most are longer than that. There is a requirement that there's a supervised delivery of yoga therapy for a period of time. And so that's different than, say, someone who just hangs out a shingle and says that they are a yoga therapist. So that piece, I think, is important to inquire about that. Yogatherapy.health is another website that is less for yoga therapists and more for the public, but there's also a listing there to find a map of people who are certified as yoga therapists.
And that would be good for listeners outside of the San Francisco Bay Area, wherever listeners might be. Yes.
Yes, absolutely. Okay. And then, and at the same time, there are people who might choose to not go through that method and are effective practitioners. So I think that the main piece is asking questions about training and experience and not being shy about that in the same way that one would if they were engaging any other health professional.
I'm wondering if either of you have any closing thoughts, points that you want to be sure to leave listeners with, or maybe things that you haven't had a chance to share yet. And I thought we'd start with you, Melanie.
Thank you. Well, I think one thing that I wanted to underscore at the end here is that yoga therapy is multidimensional. And, oftentimes we're working with different levels of the system. So it's the physical, the physiological, the mental, emotional, and even the spiritual. People are going to be able to access different parts of their system in different ways. So one person might really need practices that help them on a mental or emotional level. Another person might not be able to move. And so some focused breathing is going to really help them come into some kind of a shift in state. And another person is coming because they have something physical and they relate to yoga as something physical. And so you're going to meet the student where they are. You're going to meet the person where they is, so where they are. So just understanding that when one system, everything's interconnected. And when one aspect of our system comes into a state of coherence, a state of stability and ease, it's going to influence all these other systems. So even though it's multidimensional, we don't have one practice for the body, another for the breath, and another for the mind. It's really just a comprehensive practice. And as the body starts to get more stable, the breath can become more smooth and the mind can become more quiet. And it's so beautiful how it works like that.
Mm. And I guess what you're saying is the entry point can be at any place, right? Exactly. And may be more accessible for someone, but exactly. They're all going to be affected.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And Dr. Juko, do you have any closing thoughts or comments?
There have been so many times that I have sought support from people, healers, clinicians, who, walking through the door, saw me as broken. And inherent to a grounded therapeutic yoga approach, when a client comes into consultation, when they walk through the door, the assumption is that they are already whole. There isn't anything that's broken or needs to be fixed. There is a process of using all of these different tools: values clarification, guided self-inquiry, movement, breath, the ability to turn the senses inward, the ability to sit with sensory input and to navigate it and manage it, to manage what's happening within and without effortlessly and with ease. So that is this state of being of yoga integration that is possible. But it doesn't start with you're broken and you need to be fixed. It is that you are whole, and this world inundates us with challenges and perspectives and projections that block our capacity to see our wholeness and our courage to lead with it.
In Your Voice are short segments where listeners get to add their voice to the discussion. On today's topic, we heard from this community member.
Hi, my name is Abby. I'm a retired administrator and instructor at UC Santa Cruz. I'm currently teaching yoga at a private studio in downtown Santa Cruz, having practiced for 26 years. To commemorate my 50th birthday, I spent a month studying with the Iyengars in India. I sought out yoga in the first place when my children were young to help me cope with all of the demands made on a working mother and wife. My partner and I had 2 children, 3.5 years apart. We both worked and neither of us had any familial support, given that my mom was the sole grandparent and she lived in Los Angeles. As a result, I always felt so stressed, juggling my work life and the needs of my family, as well as my relationship with my partner. This led me to yoga at the age of 37. I enjoyed the quiet, the emphasis on the breath, the Sanskrit names for the poses, the beautiful philosophy, and best of all, how my nervous system felt calmer after a practice session. I had been a professional dancer in my younger years, so the physicality of yoga appealed greatly to me as well. The only thing missing was the music. I delved deeply into yoga and even completed a teacher training program when my kids were old enough to restrain from interrupting me when I practiced at home. A few years later, when my son was a teenager, I found yoga particularly helpful because his behavior was very challenging for me, and I had difficulty regulating my reactions to his behavior. I remember how my throat and chest used to tighten when he would push back at me. Yoga helped me tremendously during those teenage years. Deep breaths, and through my practice, I learned to be less reactive. When the kids were grown, a major trauma occurred in my life. My partner was diagnosed with glioblastoma, a fatal form of brain cancer. He had had a major stroke and was rendered blind and brain damaged, requiring round-the-clock care. We had only been empty nesters for 1.5 years. At the time, he was 52, and we were planning to retire together at 55. In terms of my yoga practice, I vividly recall a fellow yoga teacher instructing me to lie down in Shavasana, or corpse pose, the final resting pose in a practice session, with my eyes wide open instead of closing them. This advice was so contrary to what we were taught, yet if I closed my eyes, I couldn't settle down. I was having insomnia and intense anxiety because of my situation. I also had shooting pain traveling down my arms from my heart center. I was a total wreck. When my eyes were closed, I would ruminate and couldn't stop thinking about my dire situation. Keeping my eyes open was much better. And during the period of time that my partner was ill, yoga gradually became my anchor, as it had centered me during my son's teenage years. I resisted going on medication for my anxiety and sleeplessness. I managed to get through this nearly 4-year tsunami, which eventually took the life of my most cherished soulmate, with the help of a regular yoga practice, by keeping my eyes open in Shavasana, and with the kindness of my community of friends.
Thank you, Abby. We're now looking for In Your Voice contributions for 2 upcoming shows. The first is for next month's show on the choices we cannot make, what it's like to love someone and feel the helplessness of watching them make choices and decisions that appear to us not to be in their own best interest. The second is for an upcoming show on soul food, practices and activities we do to feed our own souls. To submit your In Your Voice recording for either of these, call in and leave a message or record an audio file right on your phone. Submission details can be found on the State of Mind program page at ksqd.org/stateofmind. We want to hear from you, and your voice may just be on one of our future shows. I want to say a huge thank you to our guests today, Melanie Seacat and Dr. Juco Holliday. And thanks to you for joining us here on State of Mind, Being Human and Living Well. To hear more conversations about mental health and wellness, join us on the first Sunday of every month from 6 to 7 p.m. right here at KSQD 90.7 FM. Special thanks to Jeannie Baldzikowski for audio production, to Jennifer Young for research and outreach, and to Izzy Weiss for marketing and social media. And thanks to acoustic guitarist Adrian Legg for composing, performing, and donating the use of our theme music. You can find all the past episodes of this show on our ksqd.org website by typing State of Mind in the search bar, or subscribe and get them delivered directly to your listening device on either Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Stitcher, or Spotify. Or listen through your home smart speaker just by saying, play State of Mind podcast with Deborah Sloss on TuneIn. If you like this or any previous State of Mind episodes, please help the shows get heard and found by more listeners by leaving us a rating and review on any of the podcast services, or submit your comment at the bottom of the post of any episode at ksqd.org. This is listener-supported community radio, KSQD Santa Cruz. Just remember, 90.7 FM, KSQD, your ink spot on the dial. Stay with us.